Testing. There we go. Good morning, folks. I encourage you to find your places. Gather for worship. We'll take just a moment of silence, and then we'll begin with some listening. Once again, we have been provided a glorious day. Welcome to worship. May you find needed nourishment, renewal of relationship, and encounter the divine. Gentlemen, music please.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They're like much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Welcome to Blooming Glen Mennonite Church on this beautiful Father's Day morning. We are so thankful you could join us, whether here or virtually, and we want to warmly welcome any visitors. I pray that you feel the Spirit of God moving among us. There are children's bulletins, as well as the regular bulletins, back on the welcome table in that back corner, and you can help yourself to them whenever you'd like. We have Sunday school times for all ages following worship today. Children up through grade 5 should report to the playground right after church to meet your teachers. Junior high and senior high, post high, and adult, young adults meet in rooms inside the building, and adult groups meet in various indoor and outdoor spaces. You'll find one of our elders at the welcome table after the service if you'd like help finding a Sunday school or need more information. Also today, following worship, there is a racism-related Sunday school forum and panel discussion open to all ages here in the pavilion. And just a note, the Glen Adult Sunday School class is canceled for today, so class members are encouraged to join the forum if they'd like. we gather here to worship this morning with all of the challenges going on in our lives around the country and the world. We come together as one body to worship you. From the beginning of time, the Spirit of God encircled the earth, moving with God over the face of the waters at creation, going before the Israelites in a pillar of cloud and fire to the promised land, interceding for Hannah as she prayed for a child, writing psalms, bringing visions to prophets, moving the hearts of women and men to follow Jesus, and coming as God's gift to us at Pentecost, in order to increase our access to God, that the church might be built up in love and grow to maturity. The God who gave us this gift of the Holy Spirit is the God we have come to worship today.
I invite you to find your songs. Brethren, we have met to worship. Brothers and sisters gathered in worship and praise, prayer, word, and song is a wonderful and unique thing. Let us not take it for granted. Also, I want to just give recognition to flowers here provided by Jim and Ruth Altifer, a lovely visual for the time of year in which we are enjoying. Spirit working in creation, a text in our voices together, 1978, set to a tune, Jim Clemens, 2015, which we will not sing this morning because it's brand new for us. We will sing it to a Welsh tune from the 1800s that we know as Heiferdal. We sing it every Advent, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. Bum, 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 ba-dum, ba-dum, dee-dum, bum. Oh, right on page, here we go. Spirit working in creation, bringing order out of strife. Come among your gathered people, giving harmony.
Please join me in prayer. Lord, we come to you this morning with gratitude, with praise, and with humility. We give thanks for the fathers in our lives, for the guidance, love, and nurture they provide. We come asking for healing for our community, especially for Dave Landis and Phil Rittenhouse. We ask that you give us the ability to see from the other's point of view and to unify this community so we can further your kingdom. We come asking for peace, Lord, in our hearts, in our community, and in this world. Thank you for your promises to never leave us or forsake us. Please use this offering to impact this hurting world who you so dearly love. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen. The offering can be placed in the containers back on the welcome table at any time. I have an announcement from Gifts Discernment. They said thank you to everyone who prayerfully filled out the Gifts Discernment affirmation ballot. The candidates all received an overwhelming approval, and the newly affirmed people will start their terms on September 1st. If you would like to enroll your child at Doc Mennonite Academy or Quakertown Christian School for the 21-22 academic school year, please attend a Mennonite Education Plan meeting. The first family meeting was this morning in the fellowship hall, and next Sunday, June 27th, will be the final meeting during the Sunday school hour in the fellowship hall. MEP is a covenant of mutual aid provided by our church to support participating families. Students and their families are required to complete an application and actively engage in church life, which strengthens our relationships together during the child's academic experience and beyond. Please contact Robin Long in the church office to register for one of these meetings or if you have any questions. And I would like to call Jen Huntsberger and Robin Schilling to make some announcements.
Good morning, I'm Jen Huntsberger, Children's Ministry Director, and this is Karina Huntsberger, my daughter. In case you haven't heard the news, Rocky Railway Day. Oh, that's not good enough. Do it again. Yes, there we go. Summer Bible School Fair is pulling into the Blooming Glen Station on Saturday, July 10th from 1 to 4 p.m. We have invited our community as well as our BG friends. There will be barrel train rides, inflatables, snacks, crafts, a train display, games, music, and a skit. We still need some volunteers for our Rocky Railway Day to help make this day a success. We need some helpers to set up and tear down canopies and tents and tables. We need more inflatable staff volunteers, and we need some actors and actresses for the skit. Another job that needs filling for our Rocky Railway Day is our photo booth. We need a few people to sign up for this. We have one Polaroid camera, and if anyone has another one that we could borrow, that would be wonderful. Lastly, for our Rocky Railway Day, we would like to have a specific offering project to have available for attendees to contribute to. It doesn't necessarily have to be a train theme, but it could have a tagline such as help us get whatever back on track or something like that. This is something that could be prepared ahead of time. So if you can't be there on our Rocky Railway Day, this is something you could do. The sign-up genius is in the Glen News and on the homepage of our website. Please check it out or get in touch with me. Thank you for supporting our Rocky Railway Day Summer Bible School Fair. See you there.
Good morning. And on behalf of the young adult class, I would like to invite everyone here to join us in worship with our brothers and sisters across the United States from July 6th to July 9th at 7 p.m. right here in the pavilion. Thanks to COVID, this is a really unique opportunity to take part in convention because everything will be broadcast virtually. And I went for the first time 2 years ago and was so encouraged by all the fellowship, the teachings, and the music. So if you are willing and able, please go to the Glen News, register. It's $99, and then you'll have access to all the seminars and everything for a month after convention as well. And if you can't register, that's also fine. Show up anyways. We, the young adults, will be providing drinks and dessert, and you are welcome to bring along food. We'll be here from 6 p.m. on, so come join us, eat, and please consider who you might invite. I think it's an amazing opportunity to casually introduce people to our faith and what we believe. So when you go online to sign up for Vacation Bible School, click on the link, check out the speakers. It includes people like Megan Larissa Good, John Carlson, Anna Hinojosa, and we hope to see you July 6th to 9th from 6 p.m. on here in the pavilion.
Join me in prayer, please. Lord, may the words of Archie and my mouths be acceptable in thy sight. God, we want to come today to honor you, to teach from Scripture, and to help people grow in their understanding of who you are and what you expect of us in this world. We give you this time in Jesus' name. Amen. As I pulled into church this morning, as I was coming up the road, I looked into the sky, and there was a parachutist landing right here in the field. Did any of you sound guys, were any of you here to see it happen? Okay, because he looked fine, but I couldn't quite, he came down normally. But I thought, what a way to start a Sunday morning when a guy is parachuting into your field. Maybe he just wanted to do the walking path from a different angle. Who knows? Forgive me for one other thing here. I'm not, what's the word when you need all the little details in place? There's a word for that. I'm not that guy, but there's one thing that's bothering me. As I was sitting there, and I could see this piece of tape, probably left from summer Bible school last year, John Hunsberger, and I just thought, I got to get that down. Well, Archie and I are tag-teaming a sermon today about racism, and more specifically about anti-racism. And some of you maybe are wondering, why are we having a sermon about that at this time? Can't we just have sermons that focus on our relationship with Jesus? And I would say to you that we preach an anti-racism sermon precisely because of our relationship with Jesus. One of the greatest commandments is that we are to love all people. And because we represent Jesus in the world, we want to follow his directives in the way we live in this world. And as Mennonite Christians, we are passionate about peace and justice issues. And we especially believe that the way of Jesus and his incredible love for all people includes us treating all people with fairness, with integrity, with decency, and with grace. And so we further follow the example in Jesus, too, as we especially and deeply care for those that are oppressed or that are on the margins or those that are mistreated. Proverbs 31, verses 8 and 9. Speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves. For the rights of all who are destitute, speak up and judge fairly. Defend the rights of the poor and needy. So it's really wanting to follow the way of Jesus and the principles of Scripture that lead to this sermon today. Sadly, people in our world are still mistreated and do not receive just treatment because of their race. That is not right. Nor is it God's intention for humanity. And so it's part of our call as followers of Jesus to change it. I believe that part of the work that God gives his followers on earth is to be agents of reconciliation, to be people that try to work out, to make things right when we see interpersonal discord or conflict. 2 Corinthians 5, verses 18 and 19. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. So again, I suggest that as followers of Jesus, it's not simply enough to be non-racist.
I see Scripture compelling us to be anti-racist. As we point people to Jesus, I believe that we are to oppose and try to rid society of any practice that shows prejudice or mistreatment or abuse or harm for people because of their race. Let me share some additional biblical principles along this line. In the Old Testament, God had chosen the Jews as his chosen people to share his good news, his message with the world. And even as they were a chosen people, and in fact a unique ethnic group, he led them to a specific piece of land that was to be their homeland, and then he gave them instructions as to how to treat people that were not part of their group. Leviticus 19, 33 and 34. When a foreigner resides among you in your land, do not mistreat them. The foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. Love them as yourself, for you were foreigners in Egypt. I am the Lord your God. Then when Jesus came and he announced the good news, the message that God wanted restored relationship through him with all humans, he wanted things to be made right in Christ. And so God's kingdom on earth also was a kingdom of healing and hope for all people. And Jesus lived out these kingdom values in how he treated people that were on the edges. He ministered to Samaritans. They were a despised ethnic group. He taught women, who were considered inferior to men at the time. He ate with the poor and with sinners, violating Jewish purity laws. So by example, Jesus broke down social, cultural, ethnic, and racial barriers to bring the good news to all in first century Palestine. And Jesus prayed these same kingdom values. When he asked the Father, he said that all of them may be one, just as you are in me and I am in you. That's from John 17. And we pick up that same theme as we get to the vision in Revelation, when it's described that every tribe and every tongue are falling in worship before the Lamb. Those are kingdom values that we need to imitate today. In a letter from Paul to the Galatians, Galatians 3:28, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is no male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. This scripture from Galatians reminds me that when I choose to follow Jesus and live out his way of life, one of the things that I'm called to do is to break down prejudicial barriers and to help the followers of Jesus be that. So, in that scripture in Galatians, as a follower of Jesus, I can break down gender barriers that are unfair. I can break down racial barriers that are wrong. I can break down human rights barriers as a follower of Jesus. I challenge all of us that we have room to grow in coming alongside brothers and sisters of color to influence our society and our systems to stop any form of racial prejudice or unequal treatment. Now, America today continues to struggle with issues of diversity and racial discrimination. And I believe, again, as Christ followers, we're to be part of resolving those issues, to be against racism in any form. Just over a year ago, George Floyd was killed. That was a key time of seeing injustice and unequal treatment for people of color. And Floyd's death affected me in ways that motivated me to come alongside brothers and sisters of color and take renewed action to speak out and to act out against racism. I've never had to worry about being treated differently because of my skin color. And as a follower of Jesus, I grieve that that is not true for all people of color. And I want to change that. And so, like many of you, this past year, I've gotten out there, I've walked in some walks, I've participated in some peaceful protests, because I want to take a stand against racism. And I want to take a move towards racial equality and against injustice against other people. Simply put, I believe that racism is sin. That to discriminate, to judge, to show preference or bias or intolerance or hate towards anyone because of their race or their ethnicity is against God's ways and commands. I remind you of Genesis chapter 1, verse 27. So God created human beings in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. From the beginning of human life, we were all created in the image of God. We all have inherent dignity, value, and precious worth. A few months ago, a good-sized group of us from Blooming Glen and some friends that we invited discussed and read the book, How to Fight Racism. The subtitle is Courageous Christianity and the Journey Towards Racial Justice. The author is Jamar Tisby. Here are two of that author's suggestions to orient our lives towards racial justice. Do not have contempt for anyone. Contempt can arise in us when we have feelings of superiority over someone else. It can cause us to look down on others. A second suggestion, do have an attitude of humility. Be willing to listen to and learn from people not like you, especially those with different life experiences and perspectives. We are fortunate to have people of color in our congregation. And while they do not speak for all races or all people of color, if you want to grow as a Christian who is anti-racist, then you should learn from people of color. Have a conversation with Frank Odongo or Curtis Denlinger or Phoebe Otieno or Noel Santiago or others that are in our midst who have had a different life experience. And today, as we represent Jesus in this world and we strive to be anti-racist, as we strive to create a world that is in the way of Jesus, let us also learn from our brother, Archie Knight. Come and share with us, brother.
Good morning. How is everyone? This is absolutely beautiful to be here with you today. After a year of pandemic and COVID and mask wearing and restrictions, it feels especially good to be here on Father's Day with you. Sorry. I couldn't get that one either. Why, you set me up? I got it. Here's done. See that? See how easy that is? So the blessing today to be here with you is that on Friday, Juneteenth was recognized as a federal holiday, right? So a year from now, we'll be able to have that day off and celebrate it somehow. The irony that Mike asked me to help him with this sermon today before that actually happened is not lost on me. And then also that today is Father's Day. And that to be here from the streets of Germantown, from a single parent family, means the world to me to be with you today. I don't think you understand how much your grace, your love, your compassion has overwhelmed me in the 30 some years that I've been associated with Blooming Glen Mennonite Church. Now, I may embarrass them a little bit as we get started here, but I affectionately call them Mr. Ken and Miss Dolly. I'm gonna try not to get too emotional throughout this, so forgive me if I do. It was a very, very typical summer day in what I would say was Germantown, 90 plus degrees outside. A young man from Bucks County was opening up his farmer's market stand. Another younger man was going to the grocery store for his grandmother. I had no idea that interaction that day would have me standing here before you. It is the grace and the love from Ken and Dolly who embraced me. Ken had no reason to do that other than it was 90 plus degrees outside and he was working in a butcher stand and was probably hot and frustrated because he had woken up at 4 o'clock in the morning. A typical African-American kid in the city during the summer. I probably woke up around 8 or 9, had breakfast, got dressed, decided to hang out with my friends. All the while, Mr. Ken was driving down 309 into Germantown to set up a stand by himself. And we had an interaction that day around 1, maybe 2 o'clock, where I went to buy groceries. And he just simply said, would you like a job? And I kind of went, "You talking to me?" He said, "Yeah." And that's how the relationship began. It was with that amount of effortlessness that he asked. When you're 15 years old, you just think, this white guy's kind of crazy, but I'm gonna take this job because I'd like to earn some money. I was very nonchalant about it back then. No idea that like God was at work. And that he was at work in Mr. Ken's life, Miss Dolly's life, and in my life. And inevitably, he was at work in all of our lives. So with that said, it's good to be with you. It's even better to be of you. When you talk about race, it always makes us a little uncomfortable, especially for what I like to say. Now, this is affectionately what I call people of Blooming Glen, good Christian white folk. Because I believe you are good Christian white folk. And I don't believe any of you are intentionally racist. I'm certainly not here to beat you up about white privilege or white guilt or white fragility. That's not what this is all about. As Mike so eloquently started the morning with the biblical references on why we should be anti-racist. And by the way, that's why you go to seminary, so you can do the heavy lifting and then leave the charming part to me. I appreciate that, Mike. Thank you. The reality is that when we engage each other, we need to see the individuality that is our color. It is so often said that, "Arch, I don't see your color." Well, that's a very nice way of placating your own insecurity. Or that's a very nice way of understanding that if I tell Arch I don't see his color, then it's okay for me to justify my own insecurities when it comes to race. Does that make sense? Does that make sense? I didn't hear an amen, but do you understand what I'm saying? If you say, "I don't see your color," you dismiss who Frank is. You dismiss who Noel is. You dismiss who Curtis is. Because we are all a kaleidoscope of varying shades of darkness. It's a beautiful kaleidoscope. But let's not dismiss it as a way to engage outside of what we already know is happening. Race is important in this country. It is so much so that it dictates what we do day to day sometimes. It dictates how we move about in this country. Race is so important that Christian folk like us should be engaged in the anti-practice of racism. I don't think you understand what I'm saying. We should be engaged daily in fighting racism. If you believe that tithing is a part of your Christian walk, raise your hand. You believe in fellowship in Jesus Christ in the body of the church is part of your Christian life. We also believe that everything that we can do that is in lockstep with Jesus Christ, that continues our relationship with God, is how we are to live. Amen? Then I got to tell you, being right with people of color and being against racism is also a part of your Christian life. It is also a part of our Christian life. There's no distinction between A and B. If you believe in the other tenets of what Jesus brings to the table for us, then it is incumbent upon us, it is paramount for us to be a part of an anti-racism society that seeks to diminish and get rid of racism. Now, it's an uphill battle. There's no question about it. I'm not naive enough to suggest that the 400 to 500 members of Blooming Glen can defeat racism all by ourselves. But what I am confident of is that good white Christian folk, you, need to be a part of the fight. And it's not your journey alone. I got news for you. I'll be there with you. Sometimes it is mistaken that people of color want you to do it by yourself. That's not the case. We're going to run this race together. We're not going to let you stand on an island and be by yourself. We want to continue the race and be a part of the race. It is our job to be in love and empathy, compassion, and humanity with each other. And there's only a few ways to do that, and we have to do it together. I've gotten old, so I need these readers. So if you just be patient with me for 1 second. As Christians, we are called to a higher standard of living. We're called and given the path of love, empathy, compassion, and humanity. It is incumbent upon us to this example of virtues every day. We're called to use these virtues in their truest essence. When the question of race or anti-racism comes up for Christians, there should be no hesitation in our response. As Mike so eloquently laid out, there's no question we should be engaging society when it comes to racism. To fight racism is to be a revolutionary Christian. I'm sure you're thinking, well, what does that mean, Arch? To be a revolutionary Christian, we must understand the complexity of the enemy who wants to keep racism in place, which is the mechanism of division. Does that make sense? Racism seeks to divide us. And so we understand that complexity, and we understand that it's dividing us daily. There's no room for that division in God's kingdom. We are to be one in his life and one in each other. The people who foster racism tend to be men or women or about the business and the commodity of domination, exploitation, and oppression. The dominant orientation tends to be toward the suffering of others, which is the cowardliness, the complacency, and the conformity and the indifference to that suffering. I'm going to repeat that, because that's a heavy statement when you think about it. The people who foster in racism seek the dominance of oppression, exploitation, and the cowardliness, the complacency, the conformity, and the indifference toward the suffering of others. Being an anti-racist Christian is as foundational, as I said earlier, as our prayer time, as our obedience to the word of God, as our tithing, as our fellowship with each other. We are not only called to be a part of God, be in the world but not of the world, so that suggests that we can fight racism with love, compassion, empathy, and humanity. It's just that simple. It is simple as being a Christian. Harvard professor, Dr. Cornel West, who is probably the leading public intellect, Princeton Divinity graduate, School of Divinity, he said this in reference to when asked how Christian spirituality can help in the fight against racism, he said, and I quote, "To be a Christian is to live dangerously, honestly, freely, to step in the name of love as if you may land on nothing. Yet keep on stepping because that's something that sustains you, no empire can give you, and no empire can take away." Amen. Did you get that? When we step in love in Jesus Christ, he sustains us. And we know that to be true. Through whatever sickness, whatever strife, whatever ups and downs you've had, what do? We pray, and we ask for others to pray for us. So Dr. West suggests that because of that relationship, because of that higher power that we know to love and believe in, our faith is carried through, that we need to keep stepping in our spirituality as Christians when it comes to fighting racism and not to worry about it. He says here, to live dangerously, honestly, and freely, and step out on that love as if nothing was going to happen, but we understand that he will sustain us. I need to recount a story for you of a dear friend of mine. I'm going to read it from her page. And it's important for us to understand that it's that these things happen. A few weeks ago, on a Sunday evening, a dear friend of mine was walking with her daughter right here in Perkasie. And she posted right after that. These are her words. Sunday evening in the welcoming town of Perkasie, the girls and I walked from our home to the Dairy Queen, and we were greeted with niggers being yelled at us. Great way to end the day with yet another conversation about racism. For anyone that hears me at a school board meeting, this is why. This is where my tears and my anger come from. A simple walk to get ice cream on a Sunday evening has turned into yet another traumatic experience for my family. It was a child who screamed this at us, riding in the passenger seat with a female adult driving. This is a kid that could possibly go to school with my kids or go to church with us. Now, you may think that that's an isolated incident, but I'm here to tell you that this happens far too often. It shouldn't happen in our community, and it shouldn't happen with us letting it go. This is where good white Christian folk need to step into the fray. Can only have so many voices that come to the table in these situations. But it's most important for people who look like you, worship like you, love like you, and empathize like you to help. It's a sad story that my friend had to then call the police, file a report, talk to her daughters again. But it's a reality that happens right here in idyllic Bucks County. It's a shame. It's sad. It's disturbing. But I'm pretty sure that with God's grace, his love, his compassion, and your help, we can be better. And at the end of the day, that's what we want to be. We want to be a better society. And we want to love each other. And we want to be one in Jesus Christ. Thank you.
As you were sorry for your friend, for her daughter, for you, but good for us to hear that story. To respond is difficult. Silence would be good. Our 11-year-old Maddie Stepanek invites us to consider peace. And I have to go back to Archie's first story where he encountered this ordinary white guy in Germantown doing his normal job and in making an encounter, a connection that only the Spirit of God can bring. And his word that he uses is peace. And that peace is not possible in the future. It tells me that peace has been, is now, and ever will be a possibility. And scriptures from the beginning of creation indicate that same story. But we lose our way. And then secondly, another response, that the Church of Jesus Christ must always look itself in the mirror and reinvent itself for its context. It's hard work, but it's the journey. We are not stone idols unto ourselves. We are living organisms. And the first response is that through Christ, and I'll quote you, we step in love with Jesus Christ, and Christ will sustain us. So let's begin with verse 1 and 5 of How Firm a Foundation, and then the text inside that collection of songs is the text, The Church of Christ in Every Age, and then the Matty Stepanek poem. How Firm a Foundation 1 and 5. The Church of Christ in Every Age, text from 1971. We will sing it to this South African tune that we know very well. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia. Join the text together. The Church of Christ in every age, beset by change, but Spirit-led, must claim and test its heritage and keep on rising from. Alleluia, together. Alleluia.
This is a poem by an 11-year-old named Maddie, and God has a lot to teach us through children. Peace is possible. Make peace an attitude. Want it. Make peace a habit. Live it. Make peace a reality. Share it. Peace is possible. Make peace matter, our matter. Make peace a priority, our priority. Make peace a choice, our choice. Peace is possible. We must think gently, speak gently, live gently. Peace is possible. Be happy with who you are. Be happy with who others are. Be happy that we are. Peace is possible. Role model acceptance. Love others. Role model forgiveness. Encourage others. Treasure others. Peace is possible. Peace is possible. Peace is possible.
Beyond the dying sun.
Before Archie brings the benediction, just a word. The Sunday school forum held here, if you're staying for that, We'll take about a 10-minute break and then call you back to attention with an announcement, and would appreciate as many as that can sit up in these seats here so that the panel has an audience they can relate to. And for those that are watching it online, remember you'll have to refresh your link to watch the Sunday school. Brother Archie, come and dismiss us with your benediction.
It's been said that the benediction is like the best part of the sermon, right? Because like you get the kind of free flow this thing and you say some cool stuff and everybody's like cheering and they're happy to leave church, catch the Eagles game or something like that. This is not that crazy. But I just want to encourage you all to engage this week in love, empathy, compassion, and humanity. And just a small word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for waking us up this morning and give us peaceful rest last night. We thank you for standing with your love and your grace surrounding us. We thank you because through you, all things are possible. And we believe that we can be a part of an anti-racism mission, that we can get in the midst, in the breach as Christians, and that we can do it through you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And you're dismissed. Appreciate you.